Talking about gauge repeatability and reproducibility. So today we will be talking about how we can measure gauge repeatability and reproducibility. Okay, so before we start, there are several types of gauge repeatability and reproducibility. Let's see what are those. Now, types of gauge repeatability and reproducibility, they depend on whether the standard values are available for us and the type of measurement for which we want to do. Okay, so standard value. And the measurement type. So here we can say it is non-destructive testing, and if it is destructive testing, so if the standards are available and if the standards are not available. Let's try to understand the meaning of these terms. So standard value available means that there is already some standard, like you have weights when you go to a shop, retail shop. Nowadays they are having small weighing machines with them, but there was a time, I think all of you might have seen, in the small retail shops they keep weights, 1 kg, 500 grams, 250 grams, 50 grams. These standard weights are available. So if you put one thing on the one side of the balance, on the other side you can keep these standard weights. So that's what it means, the standard values are available or not. If the standard values are available, and if you are doing non-destructive testing, we do comparison with standards. And if I'm doing destructive testing, in both the cases, I'm going to do comparison with the standards. So that's pretty easy, comparing with the standards. But so we will also talk about comparing with the standard. What does it mean? And how do we do that? While if the standard values are not available, then we do gauge R&R crossed. And if you're doing destructive testing and the standard values are not available, then not applicable. Then gauge R&R can't be done in this case. Now, what are we trying to do?
So what have you written after gauge and R&R?
Crossed. I've written crossed. So now, just a second. Yeah. So that was crossed. Just a second. So now, what are we trying to do? Let me clarify that first. So let's keep it as one side. What we are trying to do over here is, there is a measurement system which I'm already having, and I want to see if this measurement system is doing fine or not. Okay, that is what my objective is. And there are different ways in which I can do that. If what is non-destructive testing? Anyone?
Not refer to technical part.
Like
measurement or something.
Yeah, I'm taking measurement of a line, or I'm taking measurement of height or weight. Okay, so there is no, I'm not destroying the sample while I'm doing that. But let's say if I want to test the ultimate tensile strength of a material, how do I do that? I'll have to break it.
So there are techniques like radiograph. Using radiographing, we can estimate the tensile strength of the bridges where we cannot destruct those bridges.
Yeah. So, I mean, you have different techniques. So some of them, so at times you can do testing without breaking also and with breaking also for some. Okay, so, but it may be expensive. So we break it and then find it out. So you, if you're using UTM, then you are doing destructive testing. So anyway, let's go ahead. We'll anyway not be doing destructive testing part. We will be just talking about regular testing only. Okay. Now let's say I'm focusing on this part of the measurement, that is comparing with the standards. I'm only focusing on this right now. So when I'm doing comparison with the standards, then there are some terms which I'm going to write now. Some constants, like the first constant which we are concerned with right now is N, where N is the number of units with pre-inspected standard values available. Then you have M, which is number of appraisers. Appraiser, you can say it's a worker. That can be assigned to perform test. Okay, and then there is R, where we say R is the current total number of runs at any given time in the method. Now let me explain these notations. So N is the number of units with pre-inspected standard values available. You can imagine that since I'll be doing comparison with the standards, I will be needing some standards. So if I'm having weights of 500 grams, I'm having weight of 1 kg and I'm having weight of 2 kg. So can you tell how many weights of pre-inspected standard values are available? I'm writing that 500 grams, 1 500 grams, 1 1 kg, and 1 2 kg. So how many pre-inspected units are available with me? Anyone? Who can tell how many pre-inspected units are available with me? I would like to see your answers in the chat box. Abhinandan is saying 3. Anyone else? Devansh saying 8. Puneet is saying 7. कॉमन आंसर नहीं आया अभी तक. इमरान इज सेइंग 8. अनुराग 7. ओके, सो देवांश, कैन यू एक्सप्लेन हाउ?
For every weight, we have the option to either take it or not include it. So it will be 2 to the power of 3, which is equal to 8. But then we have to exclude the case where we are not taking any of the weights, which is 0 kg. So the answer will be 7.
No, you're absolutely not right. But I mean, the question is how many units are available? So 0 kg we will not consider. Other than that, we have 3.5 kg, we have 1.5 kg, we have 2.5 kg, we have 3 kg. Okay, so how many are these? So let's make the combinations. And of course, 2 kg, 1 kg, and 0.5 kg. So that makes it 7, right? The case where, so we have 7 units of pre-inspected standard values available with us. So that means you get it. Now, second, M is the number of appraisers that can be assigned to perform test. So that means how many workers are there who will be doing this measurement. Okay. Then R is the current total number of runs at given time in the method. That means it's not that how it's going to happen is these units will be there with me and I'm going to do, let's say 3 workers are there. So randomly each worker will be asked to do the measurement. Okay, and it is not that this worker is going to go only once but multiple times. So let's say each worker is going to take measurement 3 times or 4 times. So it's, we call that as a run. Now let's go ahead and take a problem. So the problem goes somewhat like this. Use 12-pound dumbbells, 12-pound dumbbells, or you can say weights, simply. Use 12-pound weights to determine whether the measurement standard operating procedure is gauge capable of telling apart differences of 5 pounds or not. So I'm sending this question in the WhatsApp group. You can see that so that you can refer it back and forth. Now have a look at this question. Can you see the question? Use 12-pound dumbbells to determine whether the following measurement standard operating procedure is gauge capable of telling apart differences of 5 pounds or not. So the what is that standard operating procedure? It is put Taylor metro scale using a dial indicator on a flat surface, adjust dial to set reading to 0, place items on the scale and record the weight, rounding to the nearest pound. So it's not only your weights which are involved over here, but there is this procedure which is also involved. So dial indicator is also used in this case, but right now we are more focused on the complete standard operating procedure, or you can say measurement system, and whether it can tell apart differences of 5 pounds or not. Okay, now let's see how that goes. So I'm sending another picture over here. I think I'll share in the slide. That will be much better. Now what you can see over here is the measurement which has been done. Okay, so using the same standard operating procedure, you can see the run over here. So 20 runs have taken place. That means 20 times the measurement has been taken. The standard unit, how many standard units are there? Can you tell? How many standard units are there? From the question, can you tell? How many standard units of measurement are there? Three. So how three? One is 12 pound, another because we are having two 12 pound weights. So we say even a single unit is considered as one standard unit. If it is the same again, like 12 pound unit is another 12 pound unit, which we are already having. So we are having two standard units. So 12 pounds plus 12 pounds. And the third one is including both, that is 24 kg, okay? 24, whatever is the unit. So 20 runs have been done, and each time, and let's see how many times each standard unit is picked. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 times first unit has been picked, and second unit, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 times second unit has been picked, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. 6 times third unit has been picked. Okay, now what does it mean? It means that we are doing it randomly and there is no sequence. So first we pick a standard unit, and the appraiser, since there's only one appraiser, there could have been more appraisers also. Generally more appraisers are there, so only one person is doing all the things. It is done, more are there, and it is randomized so that biasness does not come. Let's say if I pick three students and ask them to do this thing repetitively, so maybe four or five times if I ask them, so probably after taking two readings they may think that it is that only something. So probably third time, fourth time, they will be biased towards what they have already observed. They might not even measure and do that. So every appraiser is given random, is randomly assigned to the standard units, and the measured value is found out. So the measured value is at times it is coming 22. You can see for third it is coming 22 22 22, and but now this time it is coming 23. Okay, so it's not like every time is going to be the same value. This indicates the variation in the measurement, and we are at the end, we are writing the absolute errors here. These are the absolute errors, that is the difference between here the actual value should have been 24, but the measured value is coming out to be 22. So there is an absolute error of 2 units. Getting it? So what do I do with all this? What I have? Yeah.
Sir, so we actually considered the 22 pounds to be 24 pounds.
No, we are comparing it with the standard units, but because of the measurement error, this is coming out to be 22. We know it is 24, but it is coming out to be 22. Are you getting what I'm saying? Because of the measurement system which we are using. Predetermined values, we know.
Sir, we have 12 pounds of weight, right?
So you can something. Let me clarify. There is a weighing scale, okay? And we are having these 24 pounds dumbbells in our hands. So when I keep these dumbbells on the weighing scale, they should weigh how much?
24.
But it is coming out to be 22. Are you getting it? So what are we trying to do over here? This measurement system, like the steps which are given over here, put Taylor Metro scale on a flat surface, adjust dial to set zero to set reading to zero, place items on the scale and record the weight. This is what we are doing. And because of these three steps, there is an error that is of 2 units. Am I clear?
Yes, sir, but I couldn't understand the point of multiple standard units.
Multiple standard units it's like at times I use this, sometimes I use this weight because I've already purchased it. Okay. So it is there with me. So I can use them together also. Are you getting it? Probably when you go to a shopkeeper, you may find 1 kg weight, 2 kg weight. So he can use both of them together to make 3 kg also, no? Similarly here, I can measure 12 kg, I can measure 24 kg, two types of weights.
So why there are three, sir?
Because we've got two dumbbells. Are you getting? So why are we not treating them same? Because over a period of time, over multiple usage, one of the standards may get deviated. So that's why every standard unit of weight is considered to be separate only, even though they are giving the same value right now.
No, sir, but for 24 kgs, we require only two dumbbells, right?
Yeah.
So why standard unit is three then?
Standard, because we have given, these are the names which have been given. See, you got 12 kg weight A, 12 kg weight B, and 24 kg weight C. So instead of writing ABC, we are writing 1, 2, and 3.
Okay, sir.
Yeah, that is just we're notifying them with 1, 2, and 3. That's all.
So what's appraiser?
Appraiser is the worker. Worker who's involved in the measurement. Okay.
So the same worker for all the measurements?
Yeah, there's only one worker involved right now. For sake of simplicity, only one worker has been taken. Okay. Now, what do we do with all this, what we are looking at? So these are randomly selected combinations which we see. And we need to find out few terms. I'm going to write few terms over here now. So we will be finding out EEAE. It basically means and there is triple EAE. There are two terms. So they are representing errors. So this is expected error of absolute errors. Expected or not expected, estimated we can say. Not expected, estimated. Estimated error of absolute error. What does it mean? It means absolute error, which I'm finding out. I'll send you the picture of that screen so that we can, it will be easier for you to refer back and forth. I'm sending a snapshot of that. So you can see this. Now we are finding out absolute error already. So if I have to average out that error, I'll say it is estimated error of the absolute error. Okay. And there is EEEAE, which is estimated error of expected absolute error. So here the term expected, additional term of expected has come. Actually, if I try to explain all this expected value, we'll have to go into statistics. So right now you can just consider there are two different kind of errors which are there. One is simple. You can say this is the average error, and the expected considers the probability part of it. So we are not going to go into this part, expected value. What is the meaning of expected value right now? We will talk about it as the time progresses, then you will understand it. So with all this, these two error, how do I proceed? Next is measurement system capability. We call that as MSA, measurement system capability, and abbreviated as MSA or measurement system analysis. And this value is calculated EEAE, 6 into EEAE. Okay. And
Sir, in the last question which we had done right now,
We have not done it completely. Nothing has been done yet.
That's why I was asking, because there was written whether it is capable of recording 5 pound difference or not.
So we have not done that yet. How do we find out capability? Is now I'm coming to the point. So gauge capability. If MSA is less than D, where D is user specified maximum tolerable difference. So in this case, it is 5, which I have already told. It's there in the question D. Then we say it is gauge capable. So if MSA is less than D, that is 6 into EEAE. Is less than D, then we talk, but then we say it is gauge capable. So EEEAE is something which is, we are not concerned with that immediately, but let's see how we do this. Okay, now let's solve this problem. The formula for EEAE is, you can say, summation of absolute errors divided by N. That is not N. In this case, we are saying R. That is the number of runs we are doing. So can you tell me this value? Quickly calculate and tell me this value, EEAE value. Write it in the chat box. Yes. Okay, 1.55, good. So with the 1.55, the next thing that we need to calculate is triple EAE. And how do we calculate triple EAE? Is square root absolute error, let's say 2 minus 1.55, the first one. Then second observation. So there'll be 20 such terms here, like up to 2.1.55 whole square divided by r minus 1. Okay, and this whole term divided by root r. Okay, now you calculate this value and tell me the answer. It'll take some few minutes for you to do that. So calculate the value of triple EAE. The numerator of triple EAE is sample standard deviation, and in the denominator we are dividing it by root r. So do the calculation, and I want all of you to respond to this. Yeah, many of you have responded, like Ayush, Vineet, Prateek, Govind, Jatin, Vikas, Ambuj, Nikhil, Pawan, Harsh, Brahmadat, Yadav, Alka. All these people have responded. It seems like other people are sleeping in the class. Vineet, you have calculated very fast. Other people also, verify if he's right or not. So Vineet, if you have already calculated it, you go ahead and see if Gage is capable or not. Other people also do the calculations and write your answers. Let's see if the answer written by Vineet is correct or not. I'm randomly asking some people. Vikas is saying 0.131. Harsh is saying 0.1353. Harsha, okay. Harsha, okay. 0.132. So till now,
what is written in the denominator?
Root r.
No, sir. In the numerator, in the,
okay, numerator is r minus one. R minus one. I'll make it more clear. Okay, so we come to a consensus that it is coming out to be 0.135. 135. Okay. Now, as we have seen over here, your gauge is capable if it is less than D, 6 into EEAE. This we could have calculated earlier also, 6 into EEAE. But why did I calculate 0.135 is the question. I'll tell you that. So 6 into EEAE is coming out to be, oh, sorry. What's that value? 1.55. 1.55. So which is equal to what? 9.3. 9.3. So that means it is greater than D. So if it is greater than D, we may say SOP is not gauge capable.
So what is D?
D is 5, which is given. D is the maximum permissible difference, maximum tolerable difference from the standard value. Here in the question, it was written, it has telling apart a difference of 5 pounds. Okay, so that's how it is given as 5 pounds. Is it clear? Now,
so can you explain D?
Yeah.
D?
Yeah, I didn't get.
What is D here?
D is maximum permissible deviation from the tolerable value. Maximum permissible difference or maximum tolerable difference from the standard value, not the tolerable. I'll write it, in fact. I'll write it. Okay, but what do I do with this EEAE which has been found out, this value? So let's say if the gauge had been capable, then I would have written it as one, this could have been written as, just a second, expected absolute errors. If the gauge had been capable, the expected absolute error, because we need to specify it with the instrument. When you are selling the instrument, expected absolute errors needs to be specified. So it would be coming out as 0.135 plus minus. So the 1.55 or expected estimated absolute error is kind of an average. And how much this average, how much is variation in the absolute errors is given by the estimated value. Okay. So that's how we use the two. So we can see over here, this is EEAE and this is EEEAE. First is error, which itself is a deviation. Then how much is the average deviation? That is 1.55. And how much variation is in the variation, you can say that is EEEAE. Okay, so that is the actual use of EEEAE. these two things needs to be specified when you are selling the instruments or when you are using the instrument, so that you know that how much variation in the error is expected. Error itself is a variation, and variation in variation is expected, you can say that. So this is about what we have done today. So I'll just summarize it quickly. This is the snapshot of what we have done. So at the top, where you can see that, this is what we were talking about, the types of gauge R&R. And this one, what we have done just now, is about comparison with the standards. And we are doing when we are doing non-destructive testing. So these notations N, M, and R will be used in the next class when we'll be talking about gauge R&R crossed, which is much more complicated what we have done right now. So there will be again using these terms. So the question which we are done is, like, there are 12 pound weights which you have, and their table which I have already shared with you. So I need to find out whether this is gauge capable or not. So only one appraiser was there in the problem, and 20 measurements were done using that appraiser, and 2 pound weights, where 3 standard weights were available. It is quite possible that you might have had a 12 pound, 11 pound, and then 23 pound. That could have also been the situation.
So, sir, can you repeat the definition of D?
Yeah, D is the maximum permissible tolerance or deviation from the standard value. Okay, so then estimated error of expected absolute error and estimated error of absolute error. So estimated error of absolute error in a way indicating average error, and EEA is indicating the deviation or the variation in the absolute error. Okay, and then we find out the measurement system capability with 6 into EEAE, and found that the gauge is not capable, the SOP which is being used is not capable. That means we have to redefine SOP, or we have to change the instruments. Means if it is not capable, what do I do? Either I purchase a new one, or I check the procedure of doing the measurement. And since we are doing R&R, we are already assuming that the calibration is proper only. Okay, so maybe the worker worker needs some training could be that. So repeatability and reproducibility both could be a problem over here. But in this case, we have not actually calculated the repeatability and reproducibility, for the simple reason that the standards are already available. When the standards are not available, we do gauge R&R crossed. So that we are going to do in the next class. Also, if I have to specify error, I specify the average and along with the variation in the average. So that's why EEAE is also required along with EEAE. Any doubts?
So what is the significance of 6 into EEAE? I mean, why 6 is used here?
See, actually, it comes from the statistics. 6 indicates a variation around mean, which is 99.73% of the time. So we are going to do that in the coming classes once we are done with the gauge R&R. After that, I'm going to take up the statistical part, which will go on for 5-6 lectures, or maybe 7 lectures. So there we will be doing all these calculations and the meaning of 6. Actually, 6 sigma, which you know 6, it is somewhat related to this one only, which is variation. So anyway, I'm not going to take you into 6 sigma, but yeah, 6 is what is indicating 99.73% of the variation around the mean.
Sir, if standard value was not given, so how would have been the error calculated? Absolute error.
Exactly. So that is what we will do in the next class. That is gauge R&R when the standard values are not available. Okay. Now you guys can give the attendance, and let's finish the class for today.